going to turn this way. Otherwise, I know I'm just going to keep standing in front of it, and I don't want to do that. So hopefully we're okay here. All right. Well, hi, folks. It's wonderful to be here today. It's my first time having a chance to chat with this group, so I appreciate the opportunity to come into this space and chat a little bit about the Bird Friendly Coffee Program. So my name is Kirstin Hill. I am the incoming Bird Friendly Coffee Program Manager. So this is actually, Monday is my first official day working with the program. So I'm a little bit early here, but have been working with the Smithsonian Migratory Bird Center for a little over a year now in a formal capacity, and then in an informal capacity a few more years prior to that. So just a little bit about the Smithsonian Migratory Bird Center before we get started, sort of who we are, what we're all about. So we are based out of Washington, D.C. In the States. So I am from the States as well. So if you hear me in my accent or I'm talking too fast, that's probably why. I apologize in advance. I try to slow myself down. But thanks to Kent's wonderful coffee, that's probably not going to happen. So I'm just going to end up talking really fast. So we are the part of the world's largest museum and research complex. So Smithsonian's been around for quite a long time, lots of different museums and research institutions. We are one of them. We're one of the newer ones. So the Migratory Bird Center is actually part of the National Zoo and Conservation Biology Institute. And our corner of this with SMBC was founded in 1991. Our goal is we are dedicated to understanding, conserving, and championing the grand phenomenon of bird migration. So with a big focus on migratory bird species, in particular neotropical migratory birds. So that migration pattern that's happening between North and South America. And of course, we are home to the Bird Friendly Coffee Certification Program, which has started not all that long after SMBC came about. So we are also about 25 years old now or so within the program itself. So there we go. This is a stat, unfortunately, probably many of you are quite familiar with: the loss of about 3 billion birds since since 1970. This is a really, really dramatic decline, and something I'm sure folks in this room I don't need to spend a lot of time on have heard about this and know all about it. When we look at migratory birds in particular, it's a loss of about 2.5 billion birds since 1970. So that's about a 28% loss in population in that time. And 2 in 5 Baltimore Orioles, when you look at one of those real notable species there that we have lost. So obviously this is a big problem. This was a study that the Migratory Bird Center was a big part of. And a lot of our work since it came out has really just sort of, it's amplified the work that we're doing and just really put a big focus on how important it is that we work to conserve migratory birds. So how coffee fits into all of this is the map that you see here. This is a map of coffee and biodiversity hotspots. So all of the places that are really good for growing coffee, you need those areas right around the equator. Those are also the areas where we're seeing the most biodiversity. So this extends beyond birds. It's not just birds. It's other wildlife species as well. So the yellow there, that's our coffee growing regions. The orange is our biodiversity hotspots. And then the blue there is a cocoa growing region, which is our little teaser. That's our next certification we have coming down the pike. So when you think about coffee, these are the kind of two different examples of how coffee can be farmed. So the example that you see on your left, the L is for left, right? on your left, my right, I guess it is, that's sun-grown coffee. So that's a monoculture. It's one where a bunch of habitat is effectively removed, not just for birds, but for other wildlife as well. And it allows for a higher yield for farmers. This sun-grown coffee farming system is actually quite new. It's not something that's been around for some time. Coffee always used to be grown in the shade, as you can see on the other side of the other half of the screen there. But when the global demand for coffee really increased in about the 1970s or so, what ended up happening was farmers wanted to meet that demand. They wanted a higher yield for the land that they had. And so they eliminated a lot of that wildlife habitat within their farms. And they started growing coffee in that monoculture system as well. Now, as I'm sure you can imagine, the number of bird species, when you look at these two systems, within the sun-grown system is very, very low. Within the shade-grown system is obviously much, much higher. I mean, you could arguably look at that the shade-grown system there and you wouldn't even be able to determine that that's a farm itself. It's so wooded and so densely rich and providing such great habitat for species. So how does bird-friendly coffee fit into this? Well, bird-friendly coffee is the gold standard in biodiversity-friendly coffee farming systems. So when you go back, let's see if I can figure out how to do that. So when you go back, you can see that the shade-grown system there on the right-hand side of the screen, that's a very common term. Folks tend to know, they tend to hear what shade-grown coffee is, they know what it's all about. Bird-friendly is basically the certification system that says, hey, yep, that shade-grown, that is providing legitimate, really helpful, really healthy habitat for birds and other wildlife. So the Smithsonian Bird Friendly certification, it's a third-party certification. If you've heard of Rainforest Alliance, even Organic, Fair Trade, we are a certification system just like that. So we're not a brand of coffee. We are a set of criteria that was developed by Smithsonian ornithologists that basically says, hey, this is what's needed in order to provide effective habitat for birds on coffee farms. It's also the only shade-grown certification on the market that offers 100% product purity. So there's lots of certification systems that are out there, lots of things that may say we grow coffee in sustainable ways. Ours is the only one that is 100% every bean in a bag of bird-friendly coffee is grown in a way that protects wildlife habitat. No other certification can say that for wildlife protection. Within this coffee system, we protect nearly 1,500 hectares of habitat in 11 countries, and that number is growing. We are certifying new farms and new inspectors for those farms on a very regular basis, even during the pandemic. Just earlier this week, we had a training where we had a whole new crop of inspectors come through, and they're going to be going out certifying new farms, so that number is always growing for us. And then we're producing about 34 million pounds of coffee annually within those farms. So what does it mean to be bird-friendly certified? This is kind of a nice little infographic that that sums it up for the most part. Sorry, my fonts are a little wonky here, so I didn't have a chance to fix everything, but it's mostly there. So that criteria that you see on the bottom right-hand side, that is what it means to be bird-friendly. So when we looked at those two photos earlier of the sun-grown versus the shade-grown, that's sort of what you're seeing there. So a sun-grown coffee area can support about 61 different bird species per what our ornithologists tell us. Whereas when you look at the bird-friendly system, it's going to provide much, much more habitat for there. And it looks like I may have covered up exactly how many bird species it protects. But the criteria that you're looking at for bird-friendly certification are those things on the right-hand side there. So the big thing is it's that 40% shade density. So 40% of the crop is actually covered by trees. We do require a native backbone species and organic certification. So that's something, so no pesticides are being used, or it's a very, very limited, whatever's through the USDA and the Canadian organic certification systems, that's what we're requiring as well. And then you're looking at 12 meters of canopy height and at least three different layers of trees, tree canopy cover, in order for this to be determined as a bird-friendly certified farm. So lots of thought, lots of things that go into that that bird-friendly certification.
243.
Thank you, Kent. 243 species, so much better than 61. So how does that work? How does it work on the operational level for us? Well, we are certified at all levels of the supply chain. So a farm becomes bird-friendly certified first. So basically, if it's a farm, usually the hardest thing to overcome is that organic certification, just because it has to be re-upped every year. It's a really difficult thing for folks to get in. So if they have that organic certification and they have good shade cover on their farm, they're usually set up pretty well for success, and we can help them along the rest of the way. So our farms get certified. We have a number of farms, as we said, in about 11 different countries right now, with that number growing. We also certify importers, so the folks that are purchasing the coffee beans, the green coffee beans from the farmers, and bringing them into new markets, like here in North America. So we'll certify those folks, and then we certify our roasters as well, as we have Kent here today with us selling his brand new bird-friendly coffee and sampling it for us as well. So at that different level, it's important for us because that maintains that 100% product purity. We can track all of the beans, make sure that everything is in fact grown in a way and handled in a way, so we're keeping that that purity intact. It is a minimal cost for farms. So we as Smithsonian, we don't charge our farmers anything to participate in this program. They do pay the inspectors in order to have that happen, but that money does not come to us. Instead, we have a very small royalty that our roasters pay at that level, and that comes to us, and that funds our research and allows us to keep the program operational. We also offer a premium price for growers, which is something that we're really proud of and looking to have more of a focus on in this next little stretch here. So closing the gap. So for us, the biggest issue right now is that the supply of bird-friendly coffee coming out of these farms currently outweighs demand. So there aren't as many roasters who are buying bird-friendly certified beans and then turning around selling them with that certification label that you see up there on there. And so what that means for us is, we are at risk of losing that habitat that is currently being protected under bird-friendly certification. So if the farmers aren't getting the return on their investment for being part of the bird-friendly program, they may say, hey, this financially isn't viable for me, so I'm going to convert to a sun-grown system, or I'm going to eliminate some of that habitat so that I can do other things with my land. So one of the things that we are looking to do is to help overcome that by increasing awareness, consumer awareness, and product availability, because those are the two things that we know are very, very low within the bird-friendly program. Even within knowledgeable groups like yourselves, oftentimes we find there are folks who just haven't heard of bird-friendly, they don't really know what it is, there's some confusion around it, and they don't know where to buy it. And so that's my job coming into this new role, is figuring out how to overcome those barriers to make bird-friendly more available and accessible to the folks who are interested in drinking it. And the good news is that we have done some really great market research within the zoo and aquarium community recently, and that is driving some of the efforts to increase the sale and support of bird-friendly throughout North America. So I wanted to share with you a little bit of the survey data that's come out of that, that research that we've done. So one of the things that we did within the project I've been working on most recently is we surveyed over 1,500 zoo and aquarium supporters, so folks who have visited or follow on social media or generally consider themselves fans of AZA accredited facilities, AZA being the Association for Zoos and Aquariums. And what we found was really promising. So folks didn't always know what bird-friendly was, but then when we offered up an explanation about what it was and what it meant for wildlife habitat protection, they were really, really supportive of it. So about 86% indicated that they intended to look for the bird-friendly seal the next time they were shopping for coffee once they found out about it, and 88% wanted to see bird-friendly coffee sold at their zoo and aquarium. And so we've taken this data and have leveraged it, put it in front of the zoo and aquarium audience, and we're in the process of doing that now, but we've started kind of doing it ad hoc as these things have come up. And the zoo and aquarium leadership are saying, hey, this is really great. We want to bring bird-friendly coffee into our community and do that. So we've had about 6 different institutions that have started selling bird-friendly certified coffee since we kicked off this project. And the majority of them have done that by reaching out to coffee roasters in their own community and saying, I want you to sell bird-friendly coffee. So they're supporting something local. They're bringing it in. It's a really good growth opportunity for our program, and it's a great way for the zoos and aquariums to be conservation leaders within their community, which is really exciting. One other thing that we found when we surveyed this group was that we found our conscious consumers are willing to spend more for bird-friendly coffee, and that was something that folks were really worried about within the zoo and aquarium leadership community. They kind of said, hey, we don't want to jack up the price of our coffee. And we said, we totally understand you. We hear it. Folks have limited budgets. They're not quite sure how much they would be willing to spend. So we just straight up asked them, and that's what folks said. So they were willing to pay $2.17 more per pound than what they are currently paying in order to have a bird-friendly coffee, and $1.07 per cup, which was pretty incredible. So when we, this is not something that exists in a vacuum. We had another study that we did in conjunction with Cornell a few years ago, and that was actually came in at $2.19 per pound. So this is something that we verified on a couple of occasions now, that once folks know about bird-friendly, they're willing to pay more in order to know that the coffee that they're buying is not destroying habitat. In fact, it's protecting it. So what's next for us? What are we doing? So right now, we're taking a lot of that survey data and some of the other things that we're doing, and we're turning it into an operational toolkit for zoos, aquariums, and other nature-based organizations to use in order to promote bird-friendly coffee and the drink bird-friendly message with their audiences. So we found that drink bird-friendly is a really accessible, easy to support, and attractive conservation message for nature-based organizations and for individuals who care about birds and other wildlife. It's something that folks can easily see themselves in, something that they are interested in supporting, and kind of saying, hey, you know, I can just change the coffee that I'm drinking if I support this, you know, this certification. That means that I'm doing something that's actively protecting habitat, which you can't say for a lot of some of the conservation actions that we see sometimes. So we're using a lot of this information to that we've gathered through the project that I've been working on to kind of pave the way for future bird-friendly market growth. And we're also doing some additional research into bird-friendly systems and certifications as well through a bird-friendly coalition. So some of the things folks were talking about earlier about things like bird-friendly backyards, bird-friendly gardens, other initiatives, things like that, we're working with a big, big group of folks to see, are there other bird-friendly things that we can be doing? Within our SMBC team, as I mentioned a little earlier, we're gonna be rolling out a COCO certification very soon. Also coming down the pike likely soon after that is rice and wine. Those are kind of two of the other big areas that we're looking at. We're also working within the Metro Vancouver area to increase availability and demand for bird-friendly, and that is, I think, largely due to the fact that I am located here. I don't know if we would have a big presence in the Vancouver area if I were not here, but I kind of see this as a really great opportunity within you know, a strong birding culture in this area with the important bird area right, you know, right around the corner here. We've got a great sustainability culture when you look at, you know, sort of the big picture of what's in North America. And we've got a really good coffee market too, right? People love their coffee here. So let's bring these three things together and see if we can't increase bird-friendly availability and demand in Metro Vancouver. And that has started with working with Kent. So, did I go buy one? Nope, there we go. When we think about bird-friendly, it's not just about birds. It's about a lot of other things as well. So it's we, of course, look through the lens of birds when we think about the coffee certifications and it being the gold standard for biodiversity-friendly coffee. But it's not just birds, it's other wildlife as well that are benefiting from the habitat that's protected on coffee farms. Bird-friendly coffee farms are also better for climate resiliency. So they support, of course, the carbon sinks by keeping those trees and that habitat on coffee farms as opposed to cutting them down. And you're creating a more resilient farm system there as well. So as opposed to the monoculture, the shade-grown coffee farming systems are better equipped to withstand severe weather events and actually will protect the coffee in the case of extreme heat events as well. And which we know, I don't know if folks have heard, but there's some distressing news about the fact that coffee may go extinct, which a lot of folks are worried about for a very good reason. But that's one of those things where if you have a shade cover there, it's gonna better protect the coffee from kind of overheating and dying off. It's also a good choice for sustainable farmers. So in addition to bird-friendly certification and organic certification, we have a number of roasts that are also fair trade certified. And then supporting local roasters as well, so connecting with folks like Kent and sustainably minded coffee companies to increase that availability of bird friendly. So lots of good that comes from the program. So if you're interested in getting involved and knowing more, those are kind of the four actions. Four to me is too many, but I know a lot of folks are probably already doing some of these things, so I wanted to provide more than just the one option. So of course, buying bird-friendly coffee, looking for that bird-friendly certification seal. So that is the only way to know that the coffee that you're drinking is bird-friendly. There is a lot of different ways that folks label their coffee. Some are called wildlife-friendly. There's actually a company called Frog-Friendly Coffee. We are not affiliated with any of those. Just look for that certification. If you don't see that certification, it is not bird-friendly certified. We cannot guarantee it. So that's the really, really important thing to remember. Always look for the label. Other things you can do is invite new roasters to the program. So if the coffee you drink right now you really, really love, and they have shade-grown claims on, you know, on their packaging or within their messaging, there's a good chance that they may be purchasing coffee from Bird Friendly Farms and just not formally involved in our program. And so if that's the case, we welcome them. We want to bring them into the program. We would love to see them formally involved in the Bird Friendly program with that label on their bag. So we're always looking for more folks to join the program, always looking for those leads of local coffee companies who are kind of doing the right thing. Of course, also talking to your grocers. So requesting bird-friendly coffee wherever it is that you buy your groceries, we know it can be really tough to find sometimes. There's a few locations that we know locally are coming in, and we're always looking to populate our map on our website to make sure that we have the most up-to-date info on where you can actually buy the coffee itself. And then, of course, tell your friends. So word of mouth is a really, really powerful tool for encouraging this action. So if you are keen on Bird Friendly, tell your friends to drink Bird Friendly as well. There's lots of different ways to purchase it. The best way at the moment is probably to go to that drinkbirdfriendly.com website, which is our, that'll direct you to our Bird Friendly homepage. And then from there, you can see all of the different ways that you can purchase Bird Friendly, either locally or online through our website as well. So, managed to click out of that, there we go. That's all I have for folks for now, just on that overview for the Bird Friendly Coffee program. I'd be happy to take any questions folks have, or if you're interested, of course, check out our website. You're also welcome to shoot me an email at any point as well if you wanna have a more in-depth conversation about Bird Friendly.